So now we are moving over to our discussants, and we have two discussants who are willing to bring in their own thoughts, maybe comment on some of the speakers, but really will make their own case for what we should be doing moving forward to COP23. And we'll start with Faustine Wabwire. And she's a senior foreign assistance policy advisor at Bread for the World. And she'll tell us about both the presentations and what we should be doing moving towards COP23. Thank you very much, Faustine.
So I'm gonna give you a break from PowerPoint presentations just for a few minutes. I will basically just respond to what we've heard, and I really appreciate all of the information that has been shared so far. Bread for the World is really about taking a lot of the excellent research and evidence and presenting this to policymakers so that we actually deliver action. And I'll just start by sharing a story. In the summer of 2015, this was really in the space when the Paris Agreement was being negotiated and so much was going into that. I managed to visit a really rural village, I would say marginalized in many ways, in the northern part of Kenya. And I was speaking to this 76-year-old grandmother who had, you know, been riled up by the fact that there's something happening about climate change negotiations, that at some point she'd be able to deliver nutritious and sufficient food for her many grandchildren that she was very proudly, you know, sharing with me. And she said to me something that really struck me, because I had shared with her what I do at Bread for the World. And she said, well, we hear much of what happens at our local level comes from Washington. So can you assure me that at some point, that, you know, climate change is going to be a thing of the past and that I'll be able to feed these children? And the look in this woman's face kind of just sobered me up, that there is a lot of evidence, there's a lot of hard work going into research, but then how do we translate that into outcomes for communities that are really grappling with these issues on an everyday basis? And I really appreciate the conversations around climate change that is picking up steam, that policymakers are paying attention to this. But I must also say that it's very unfortunate that it's coming a bit late for the communities that have been grappling this for decades now. And so as I learn and from the communities that I have visited, I'm also just struck by the presentations and the very many points of convergence that have been expressed in this. I'm struck, first of all, by the encouraging structural shift from looking at agriculture, food security, and nutrition as separate components toward a more systems thinking approach. In other words, we are able to understand the key components of food security and what a resilient system looks like. We talk about production and we talk about distribution. How does infrastructure factor into even the upcoming conversations in Bonn? But then I'm also struck by the conversation around urbanization. And I think it's true that increasingly the consumer of the food is more removed from the point of production, which means that has implications on the choices, as presenters have said, on the availability of the food that these people will have. And it also has raises questions of price, because as food is transported from the areas of production towards the market and trade chains, there's always an additional cost. So how do we really address the issue of increasing availability of food while at the same time maintaining the nutritional quality of the food, and especially more as we move toward high quality diets? We know that for about a century, much of the conversation in the food space has been about increasing more food, but we are also very aware today of the need to deliver better, healthy, nutritious diets for communities around the world. And so the questions of how do we balance diets, how do we diversify diets, and just keeping in mind the rural, mostly poor person. Because I think as we talk about nutrition, let's not forget that also majority of the food producers don't have much choice in as far as accessing the high quality, perhaps high protein diets that we are advocating for. So I, as many of you have seen, and I think the last seminar here at IFPRI really focused on the latest state of food security and nutrition, which paints a sobering picture that we are actually losing the progress that we've made over the years. And a number of factors are responsible for that: conflict, climate change, obviously, but also leads me to the question, are we investing enough? Are we paying as much attention to the research that is coming out of these wonderful organizations? How do we hold ourselves and policymakers accountable? That's really what I do for a living, so I could talk about this for a very long time, but I will be getting into that as we proceed. I think the challenge that is ahead of us is a real one, in the sense that, looked at one way, we are at a crisis moment. I like to be an optimist, but let's face it, that we are in trouble as far as achieving the aspirations of the 2030 agenda if we don't very quickly get a, you know, really action moving on climate change in order to deliver nutritious diets. We know, as Jessica and others have mentioned, the consequences of achieving good nutrition, given a rapidly changing environment that is decimating production, that is lowering the quality of foods that communities provide. And yet we also know that about just 1% of global development aid goes to addressing malnutrition, specifically malnutrition. So there are gaps as far as what is the evidence that's coming out of research, what we need to do versus what we are actually doing. And I think going into COP23, we have an opportunity here because with time we are getting a little more information about how to link food security and nutrition systems, perhaps identifying goals and objectives on food security and nutrition and linking those very closely with goals and objectives on how to achieve a climate resilient environment. So I will just mention again that accountability is really what I would call for at this point. As we continue to do research and analysis to inform policy making, we really need to come up with frameworks that allow citizens to hold their governments and the global community accountable, because we cannot wait anymore. So I will stop there and look forward to further discussions from you.
Thank you very much.